I'm just a PhD student, to put that out there. I put COO up there because I think it makes me sound good. My CEO should actually be here, but he's skiving off doing proper science, so I'm here and I'm it. But before I get started, I just want to kind of get a handle on who I'm actually talking to, because unlike many other people in this room, I've honestly got no idea. I know Kate, and I know Catherine and Charlene, and I know some of the Grow Wellington people and Karen, but other than that, don't know any of you, and that's a crying shame. So can I just get hands up, any academics in the room? Right, okay, minority. Industry, business people? Okay, and then we've got some others, or refusal to participate. Good, I like others, they're interesting people, I think. Without further ado, I'll get started. Oh, one last question before I do get started. How many of you guys have either done or have had some close interaction with postgraduate study in science or engineering? Oh, good, 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 fantastic. So, I'm here to talk to you, and I'm going to be very brief, probably 5-10 minutes max, unless I get really distracted, about Chiasma. And Chiasma is an organization that has been running in Auckland for the past 8 years that's been getting students and forcing them to interact with industry. And this is addressing a problem, and I'll explain that problem in a moment. Myself and my CEO, Ben Mallett, who are both PhD students with the McDermott Institute, with some support, guidance, and being hit on the head by Kate now and again, to give us a wee bit of direction, decided that Wellington needed this. And so we asked if we could copy their model and bring it down to Wellington. And they said, sure, go nuts, knock yourself out. So that's promptly what we did. So what we're trying to do is get students to talk to industry to deal with this so-called brain drain and this kind of lack of innovation, I guess. And before I go too much further into how we do it and what we do and what we're about, I just want to say why. So this is a question that's been knocking around in my head for quite some time as an interested person. It's been really cool seeing the amazing stuff that we've already heard talked about today, but there's not so much in terms of getting students involved. And that's a real shame. I think there's a lot of innovation that students can come through, and students by and large are quite interested in something like this, but there's a problem in that they've got no idea where to start, and that's where we kind of step in. We try to get them through undergraduate, postgraduate, PhD, postdoc, any level, and try and get them to interact with industry and get some idea of what the real world is actually like, because to be honest, most of them have no idea. My own research is kind of linked to biomedical. I work on a device that detects nanoparticles, or that's the idea. Sometimes it does, most of the time I just screen it and it doesn't work. But I go in and I begin my talks to students by saying that there's a $350 billion a year US market for this stuff. And I see two reactions, and they're quite interesting. One of them is that most academics will go, and students will either do the same thing or their eyes will just bulge. It's like they've never heard a number like that before, nor have they thought about a number like that in the context of their research. And I worry that that's becoming an increasing characteristic of science and engineering graduates. They just seem to have no idea about the real world. And it's not because they're not interested, it's not because they're not smart. It's because while you do a PhD, you tend to be very focused, I guess. So the way we're going to try and fix that is by retaining things like high-skilled graduates in New Zealand, but particularly in the Wellington region, because we like Wellington. I like Grow Wellington, and I like the interesting things that are being done here by people like Karen and Nacinthas and all these other cool people. And I've mentioned already educating industry about the abilities of students and educating students about the interests and needs of industry, which are two quite different, distinct, but quite interesting tasks. And the final thing that we're trying to do is to minimize risk. So myself and Ben started this because we realized there probably wasn't going to be a job for us in academia. Ben, I think, if he wanted to do academics, he could be fine. I'm not quite on the same page as most academics, I find. And it's really strange because about 2% of science engineering graduates actually end up in academic jobs. But they spend 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 6 of postgraduate study preparing for just that eventuality. And that to me reeks like a huge waste of time. So what we did, we went out and we started talking to these businesses and saying, okay, well, what's your view? How do you feel about these students? Do you find it hard to find highly skilled graduates? One of them, a little company called Patronics that makes fire alarm systems, they make printed circuit boards out in the hut, lovely guys, said we didn't actually know that there were that many in Wellington. They had a job advertised for an electrical engineer for 6 months and they had three applicants, all of which they binned. That's just shocking. And then we've got students coming out with qualifications going, right, I can't get a job in academia, I don't know about New Zealand, what about Australia? Let's go drive a truck in a mine. That sounds fun. I can make 100K a year driving a big truck. No, I say it like that, it actually sounds a bit more entertaining than when I originally thought about it. But the reason we kept talking to industry, and the thing we found, the common theme between a lot of industry, wasn't that they didn't know the students were there. They knew there were students there. They're aware of them, kind of like being, you know, if you're eating steak in a restaurant, being aware that somewhere there's cows on a farm. They knew they were there, but they had no idea of the intervening process, and neither did anyone else. So the big stumbling block we found was that they had no idea how to use this resource, and they were scared of it. There was funding out there for them to get students for short periods of time to work with them. They wouldn't touch it with a barge pole. They weren't worried about the money. They were worried about the amount of time it takes to get a student relevant in an industry. If you imagine, as most businesses in New Zealand are, small to medium-sized business, a few people, they have one brand new employee who's completely useless for a year or 18 months. And I can completely sympathize as to where they're coming from. If I was running that business, I wouldn't touch those students with a barge pole either. And to me, that's a huge crying shame. So one of the things we're trying to do is we're trying to set up a framework for this relationship to continue. We're trying to minimize the risks to business, both financial and time investment-wise, to get students and actually give them experience in the real world, because this is what we believe will grow them the skills and the networks and experience and everything you need to actually become the next generation of entrepreneurs and innovators and growers in the Wellington region. And so this is our vague outline of how to do that. I'm going to skip over it very quickly. If you want to know details, just come and have a chat to me afterwards or have a look at our website that I'll throw up at the end. At the end of March, on the 29th, we're having our launch. So to start off, we're saying, hey Wellington, here we are. And that's a big part of why I'm here today, I guess. We're bringing together people from academia, industry, students, all the high-tech people we can get from across Wellington. Bringing them together, putting them in a room. It's at Te Papa in Icon, so it's a nice room. Thanks to Wellington City Council for getting us that for free. Otherwise, we wouldn't have been able to afford it. And we're just going to try and get these people to interact, to talk, to dialogue. The other big thing about students is that they've got no idea of the cool stuff going on just around the corner. I know a bunch of people, a bunch of PhD students out of IRL that don't even know that Mesynthes exists. Isn't that just a travesty? Admittedly, they're not in the biotech area, but I think that's a complete travesty, not when something so interesting is going on right next door. And that's not an isolated example. There's a bunch of cool things going on around Wellington and around the hut that no one quite seems to be aware of in the student world. The second thing we're doing is actually getting a database of these students and finding out about them. So a lot of you will be aware of the Summer of Tech, Summer of Code program that currently runs. They do this hugely effectively. They get students, so anywhere from 300 level students upwards. They talk to them, they educate them, they put them through boot camps, and they get them jobs, they get the best of them, jobs in the software engineering, web design kind of startup arena in Wellington. And that's been going really successfully. We're looking at expanding that model by getting a database of these students in chemistry, biology, physics, engineering, any science or engineering that you can find, we're interested in it, and design as well, I should add, because that's a huge part of it, and making it accessible to employers. So you can actually go and find interesting and interested employees out there in the real world. We also run workshops, so we've got three workshops this year. Two of them are kind of mundane, I'm not too excited about them, but they're necessary. The first one's on science communication. As I'm sure many of you will be aware, this is a skill that many scientists and engineers do need a little bit of, how can I put this delicately, prodding or poking or encouragement to develop. One of them is on CV writing and networking, because it's actually remarkably hard to go into a room and talk to a bunch of people in shirts when you've been stuck in a lab for 3 years and get something meaningful and useful out of it. And the final one, I'm really excited about it, not just because I came up with the idea. Sorry, some shameless self-promotion there. But the third one, we're running an intro to Wellington industry. We're bringing together a bunch of people, hopefully Miss Synthes. I've got Nancy, she said yes, but I think she has to run it past you first, to come and just talk to students about the cool stuff that they do and their experience with Wellington, from all aspects, from engineering to computer design and everything else in between, because students are interested. We also do site visits, so face-to-face is really important. We love the digital high-tech stuff. I spend all my day on the internet, but I never do any work, but we feel site visits are really important for constantly feeding back, for finding out what industry wants, because industry's needs change as well. And so we go and we talk to them, we ask them about it. And the final thing is Synapse, and I should highlight that. Synapse is our once yearly large networking event. We bill it like a career expo on steroids, because modern career expos don't work. That's certainly my experience. You go there, you get lollies and free pens, and you turn around and go home. It's not so much what I think a career expo should be about. Who knows, I could be wrong. But I just want to finish up with a couple of notes, because this comes down to a people problem, I think, because PhD students are interested, and they're interesting, and I realize I'm repeating myself, but let me give you a snapshot into what I believe a modern PhD student is. They're a person that spent 3 years of their life focused on one tiny, tiny area of engineering and science. And so, naturally, their worldview becomes pretty focused. But there's more than that. These are the kind of students that work throughout weekends. These are the odd ones that come in at 2 a.m. in the morning to check if their experiment is working. These are the ones that are absolutely committed to what they're doing. And we're losing, they're nut jobs. And we're losing these nut jobs overseas. And I want to highlight two of them up there in the corner. They probably realize this when I've invited them along. But Catherine and Charlene are two of the best and brightest PhD students I know. They are both in the biotech sector, so if you're looking to employ. but my point here is not that they're amazing scientists. They are, don't get me wrong. My point is that their extracurricular stuff, the stuff that I know as a fellow student that you guys don't, would make me trust them with my life, and certainly with my business. I can say that unequivocally. There are other PhD students I know that I wouldn't trust with a quarter or a dollar or anything, and I can tell you the difference between those, and that's where Chiasma sits. Chiasma sits squarely in that place where we know who's good, we know who you can trust, and we know who has the skills in the right areas. All we would like to do with you guys is help you to find them, and help you to use them to the best of your ability. And I think I'll finish it up there.